its composition, like mineralogical composition. Okay, so when a sedimentary rock composed of a particular or unique physical properties, so it definitely define or it will definitely indicate its formation under some specific set of physical, chemical or biological parameters. Okay, so by studying facies analysis, we can infer regarding the depositional environment of any sedimentary rock under which and how that has been deposited, that we can define or we can predict. So this facies itself is a product, you can say. So study of facies itself defines it's a product, and whatever different physical activity or chemical activity or biological activity for which that has been formed, so those are the mainly the causes or the responsible factors which has formed that particular set of physical or chemical or biological characteristic of those sedimentary rocks. And in nature, we know there are different kind of depositional environment. Okay, so each and every environment has been defined by its different physical characteristic as well as a set of facies. Okay, so this arrangement of these facies are quite predictable because whatever depositional environment, those are quite organized in nature, so that we will discuss in the later part. So facies is mainly the product of and by studying facies analysis, we could be able to define or we could be able to predict under which that particular set of facies has been deposited. Now in this lecture, what is facies, that has been told already. Now we will be discussing why we do facies analysis and how to perform facies analysis and how it is important in sedimentary mapping. Now coming to the different facies type, if we want to define the different facies type, so those can be defined in or divided into lithofacies, biofacies and ichnofacies. So being a sedimentologist we are much more concerned about the lithofacies only, whereas the paleontologist used to do the biofacies as well as the ichnofacies. That is also nowadays a part of sedimentology. Each and every book you will find a chapter on ichnofacies or ichnofossils, so that is also a part of sedimentology nowadays. So there is a different lecture on that ichnofossil and ichnofacies, so that will be dealt. So we are much more concerned regarding the lithofacies being a sedimentology. So that is what is lithofacies, that is mainly based on the lithology. So within lithology also we can get different type of sedimentary structures, and we need to see the different grain size, grain composition, grain characteristic, so that textural as well as the mineralogical property of the different rocks. So combining all together the different sedimentary structures, different grain size as well as the different composition of the rock, we can define the different, or we can divide the different lithofacies into in a different way or different manner. Like here, for example, cross-bedded sandstone lithofacies, or you can also say large scale cross-bedded sandstone lithofacies. So if by listening the name, that is large scale cross-bedded sandstone lithofacies, it itself defines that might have been deposited under a high energy condition. And coming to the another is biofacies and ichnofacies, that is mainly the based on the different trace fossil assemblages like different ichnofacies, like for example Crugiana ichnofacies. So there are few examples of the different lithofacies, like in this left hand upper corner you can see that there is a herringbone cross bedded sandstone lithofacies, and if anybody can say that herringbone cross bedded sandstone lithofacies, that we can by seeing that, by hearing that that might have been deposited under some tidal action. So we can infer those things. Here you can see large scale cross-bedded sandstone lithophases. Then you can see that ripple cross-laminated sandstone lithophases. Then nodular limestone lithophases. So these are the few of the examples of the different lithophases. Now coming to the ichnophases. So as I told you, there is a different one lecture is there on trace fossil and its implication. And so that the different trace fossil that has been grouped into or that has been divided into different ichnophases. So those are nothing but the assemblages of different trace fossil species or genera. So by seeing or by identifying those genera or those trace fossils, we could be able to identify the different ichnophases under which they are coming. So then also we can infer regarding the depositional environment of those sediments under which that has been deposited. So we look for facies analysis that itself defines that facies, that the facies refers to the sum of the characteristic of sedimentary unit commonly at a fairly small centimeter to meter scale. So what are those things we need to look for doing the facies analysis? Those are mainly, first and foremost important thing is the lithology, then sedimentary structures, different sedimentary structures we need to see, then grain size of the rock, what are the different grain size of the rocks that we need to see, then composition, what are the different mineralization that sedimentary rock composed of, so we need to see the composition. Then we need to take the paleocurrent direction wherever possible, wherever we are getting some cross-bedded strata, subtribal imbrication, flood cast. So there, from there, we need to take the paleocurrent data. Those are very much important for facies analysis. Then color of the rock, then biogenic content, what are the different fossil content present within those particular set of sedimentary rock. Those also we need to see. Then contact relationship. So and geometry of the litho unit. This contact relationship and geometry of the litho unit, these two are very much important, because for if there are different sedimentary unit present, so within that we can have the different sedimentary unit present one above another. So how they are arranged and how the contact relationship is there, so that we need to define whether that is there is an erosional contact like this can find, or there is a sharp contact like this, or there is a gradational contact that we need to mark. Then geometry of the litho unit, that is also very much important thing, that is geometry of the litho unit. By seeing, we need to closely observe the different sedimentary unit, how the geometry is present within that particular unit. Like suppose if we are getting some sand body and that is showing some lensoidal characters, if that is showing some, suppose we are getting some sand bodies and if it is showing some lensoidal character, then that means it is indicating that is a product of some channel. Okay, so that is a product of sub channel, so that we can infer. So this contact relationship as well as the geometry of the litho unit is very much important for doing facies analysis. So now you can ask that so lithology, sedimentary structure, grain size, composition, paleocurrent direction, color, biogenic content, contact relationship and geometry of the litho unit. So all these things we need to observe for doing facies analysis. So we can now we can also say that all the things are a component of sedimentary rock. So we can also redefine the facies as a that facies is a study of the sedimentary rock as a whole, because all the things we need to observe for doing the facies analysis. Now why we do facies analysis, what is the importance for doing facies analysis? So what are those? So first of all, to reconstruct the paleo environment in space and time. With respect to space, in different spaces, geographical locations, how the depositional environment was there, and due to which condition, under which condition, physical condition, physicochemical or biological condition, that sedimentary rock has been formed in different places, as well as the how the depositional environment or the paleo environment has been changed. Also, we can tell by doing the facies analysis to reconstruct the lithostratigraphy. For doing any kind of lithostratigraphy of an area, that also this facies analysis also will very much helpful by doing facies analysis, reconstruct the lithostratigraphy of an area and to know the depositional environment or the system. So for a particular set of rock under which depositional environment that has been formed, so that also we can say under which that has been deposited. Now, what is depositional environment? We need to know what is depositional environment. So, what is depositional environment? So, depositional environment, first of all, that has to have some geographical location where some particular set of physical, chemical, and biological or activities are going on. So, if we want to define the depositional environment, it refers to areas of Earth's surface where distinct processes generate physical specific geological products. So this specific geological product, is nothing but the facies. Okay, so that refers that this is a, as I told you, that this is a geographical location or areas of the Earth's surface where distinct processes generate specific geological products. So a specific kind of depositional environment or the distinct processes will generate a specific set of different facies. Okay, so by studying those facies, we could be able to infer regarding the depositional environment. That is nothing but that those distinct processes under which that particular set of facies has been deposited. That we could be able to infer, or that we could be able to tell under which that has been deposited. Now, for example, you can see this is an example of fluvial environment. So, as I told you before yesterday also, that fluvial depositional environment has mainly two components. One is channel itself. There are different processes acting in the channel, and another is the floodplain, where a specific kind of physical activity is to be going on. So this is an example of this fluvial environment. So if I am talking about the channel, then we can say this is fluvial environment. And if we want to, and now what is depositional system? What is depositional system? So depositional systems are assemblage of multiple processes, that is related sedimentary facies assemblages, commonly identified by the geography in which deposition occurs. For example, near-shore depositional system, deep marine depositional system, glacial depositional system, fluvial depositional system. So if I am telling fluvial environment, as I told you, that fluvial environment has two major components. One is channel and another is floodplain. So if I am telling only channel, we can say that is fluvial environment. Okay, so if I am considering both the things, how that floodplain has behaved during the deposition, how the channel has been behaved during the deposition, if I take all together, then we can say that is the whole thing is a fluvial depositional system. Now, these depositional systems are the mainly the modern, and those used to interpret ancient sedimentary succession and vice versa. So these different identifiable different depositional environment or the different depositional system that has been identified on the basis of the modern days feature that is acting in different geographical locations with the different set of physical activity. So we used to take that as a model, to interpret the ancient one as well as for recent one. By seeing the recent one, we could be able to interpret the ancient one, as well as seeing the ancient one also, we can compare with the recent one. Now, that is why That is why this phases analysis we use to interpret in terms of the process response model. Now, what is process response model? For example, if suppose there is a process that is ocean basin, if I am considering one ocean basin, so within that ocean basin, if the condition is under deeper water and there is low current velocity, and where settling mainly dominates, so there what we can get or what we can infer that we should get there, so we can very well expect laminated mudstone with abundant microfossils. Okay, so the product or the response elements are mainly the faces. By seeing faces, laminated mudstone, that means that mudstone is nothing but the product of the mainly the because of the suspension fallout. And as there is suspension fallout, we can also infer or we can say there will be a lot of microfossils may be present. So if we are getting this kind of different elements like laminate with abundant microfossils, then we can say that has been deposited under some deeper water condition where there was a very less current or mainly settling was dominated because of which that has been settled down and that has been deposited. So we have the product and we can't see the process, okay, under which that has been deposited. So we have the product that is nothing but the rock, that is nothing but the sedimentary faces. By seeing those sedimentary faces, we need to be regarding the depositional environment or the different processes responsible for formation of that particular set of sedimentary faces. So being a geologist, we often used to work or think backward. So we have the product, we cannot see the process, but we need to interpret or we need to infer regarding the different processes under which that has been deposited or that has been formed. So our job is like a detective job. We have some clues, we need to see, we need to identify those clues, and those clues will help us to tell us regarding the different process due to which that is the responsible factors and because of which that has been deposited. Now, so if we are doing faces analysis, is it audible to everyone? Is it audible?
Voice is breaking at some point of time. The voice is breaking.
Okay.
In between.
Okay, so then I'm PO. Okay. I'm closing my webcam. Okay. Okay. So now a story to tell, a puzzle to solve. So there are a lot of different faces are there. So that will tell some of the stories we can infer, and we need to solve that particular puzzle. That is nothing but that we need to infer or we need to find out what the culprit, that is nothing but the depositional environment or the different processes that is responsible to produce that particular set of different sedimentary faces. Now, that has been told what is faces. Now, what is faces associations and what is faces succession? So, what is faces association? Those are these faces associations. As per the definition, these are the collection of multiple faces, often in vertical cycles, resulting from genetically related accumulation and modification. Okay. So, if I just give you an alluvial environment. Okay. So as I told you, in fluvial environment, there are mainly two components. That is, one is channel and another is mainly the floodplain. Okay. So what we can infer or why we can expect within the channel, as there will be current, so we can expect mainly sand dominated faces or the sand dominated sedimentary unit. We can expect, very well expect itself within the channel. But whenever flood will occur, so that will that will uh, uh, that that water during the flood event, that water will go and that will be flooded completely, and within that flood event or within that flood plain, we will be getting mainly the finer material. There are mainly two components, that is flood plain and the channel itself. So we can say within the channel we can have the dominance of the sandstone, and within the flood plain we can have the dominance of mainly the mudstone or the muddy unit. Okay, so within those flood plain will be component. So that different component we could be able to identify if we could extract the different phases within those flood plains. Okay, and signing. Okay, so within that and within that channel itself, so there will be different lensoidal sand bodies, there will be cross-bedded sand bodies. So overall, if I can say, if we are working in a fluvial system, that we know that that has been deposited in fluvial system, or in a modern day, if we go some in Ganga basin or Brahmaputra basin also, we can say that we can identify or we can distinguish them, the different phases, into different phases association. Like say I am saying sandstone phases association and mudstone phases association. So the moment I am telling the sandstone phases association and mudstone phases association for a fluvial deposit, so it will define that the sandstone phases association itself defining the different component of the channel itself, and association itself defining the different component of the flood plain itself. Okay, so in this way, if we can club the different sedimentary phases into different phases associations. Okay, so in this way we can define the different phases association. Now this phases analysis or this phases association or phases succession, those are dependent whether we should approach in a phases association manner or whether we should approach in a phases succession manner. That will completely depends upon the objective of the work. Okay, what is your main objective for your doing your phases analysis? So depending upon that, we need to define or we need to club the different phases into either phases associations or phases successions. Now what is phases succession? So phases succession means the different variation of the phases in a vertical manner, so that is called the phases succession. So in a section or in a succession, what are the different variation in the different phases, so that is define the phases succession. So when we need to do the phases succession, suppose my objective is to do to infer the depositional environment ancient time, so how that depositional environment has been evolved with time, or the how the depositional environment has been changed with the time. So that time if I do a phases succession, if we prepare a phases succession, so that will define us that the different depositional change of depositional different depositional environment with time. If suppose in that way, if I want to do the want to extract the different component of that any kind of fluvial environment of a given area or a given work, then we can do the phases association. So how we'll be doing our phases analysis, that depends completely upon the objective as well as the worker or work that they are doing, for which on the basis of that we need to define the different phases as well as the different phases associations and phases or we can do the phases analysis. Now for example here, some example has been given that say conglomerate phases association. So the moment I am telling conglomerate phases association, it itself defines that the these are the product of the very high energy condition. So within that, suppose we are getting, if we are getting different phases like Lodgement, Tillite, LF, means that is lithophases. So Lodgement, Tillite lithophases, normal graded conglomerate lithophases, reverse graded conglomerate lithophases, polymictic orthoconglomerate lithophases, like that. And like that mudstone phases association. So that means the itself, this phases association, mudstone phases association, itself define, those are the product of very low energy condition. So for example, and within those particular, the whole low energy condition, we can find the element by defining the phases present within the basis within that, like massive sandstone lithophases, bioturbated mottled mudstone phases. This way we can club the different phases into phases association, and we can define the different phases under the different phases associations. Now coming to the phases, so after doing phases analysis, if we could able to identify the different phases, and we'll be doing phases analysis, then after that we need to propose some model so that the later worker, future worker, can refer your work, or they can compare your work with their own work. So we need to propose some comprehensive phases model. So after doing all the phases analysis, so we need to prepare a comprehensive phases model in which that the different depositional environment, or the different elements of the depositional environment or the depositional system, that will be defined and anybody can correlate with their work. So we need to prepare some phases model. So now coming to the relationship between the phases architectural elements and depositional setting and the depositional system. So what is architectural element? Architectural elements are nothing but the architect. That means how the different sedimentary units are arranged with each other. That defines the architectural elements. That is nothing but the relationship and how the different sedimentary unit has been arranged with each other. That defines the architectural element. So this is after Walker, 1992. So phases, as I told you, that phases can be combined into the phases associations, phases successions, and architectural elements. Okay, so depending on the objective, depending upon the requirement, we can define the different phases into different phases association or phases succession, or we can extract the different architectural elements. Then we can compare with those things with the modern analog, whatever modern analog has been. So we can compare those things with the modern analog, and that will, and by comparing those things, we can prepare our comprehensive phases model there. And then there will be that, because that phases model, that phases model, this model characterize, or that will define a depositional system, and the different depositional environment we can club with that, and we can prepare our different depositional system under which those particular set of phases or the sedimentary rock has been deposited. Phases analysis and Walther's law. This is very much important to understand the Walther's law. Without Walther's law, we cannot do phases analysis, and which is this is one of the fundamental law of sedimentology. So what is Walther's law? During BSc days or MSc days, we used to study that. It is a basic statement of far-reaching significance that only those phases and phases areas can be superimposed primarily, which can be observed beside each other at the present time. That means that the phases that the phases that occurs in conformable vertical successions of strata also occur in laterally adjacent environment. Okay, so what does it mean? That means if we are preparing some vertical succession, so if we are preparing the vertical, whatever we are seeing today's one section, so if we want to prepare one vertical section, it will be look like this. Okay, so that defines whatever sedimentary rocks are present one over another. So that defines the that particular set of physical condition due to which that particular set of sedimentary rock has been deposited. So those are lying adjacent to each other. That means different depositional environment or the different physico biological physico-chemical characteristics or the those are thing adjacent to each other. Though those are different, but those are adjacent to each other. As those are different, with time, as the different environment has been migrated from one place to another place, so we will be seeing one over another. So to understand that particular this Walther's law, I want to give an example of say alluvial fan environment. Okay, so in alluvial fan environment, what we can we'll here in this alluvial fan divided into three dominant region, that is we can say that is one is called proximal zone and another is the mid fan zone and another is the distal, that is the far behind from the alluvial fan, that is the distal zone. So what we can see here in this proximal zone, as the you see the slope is very much or the greater, so within this proximal zone we can have a very larger clast. So we can expect the pebbles or the conglomeratic unit within this proximal zone. And in this mid fan zone, what we can get that is mainly is mainly dominated by the of gravel as well as sandy unit. Okay, and then in the distal part, what we can have and have the very fine sand as well as muddy material we can have. Okay, so at the proximal part we can have coarser material, then the mid part we can have the sand and pebble alteration. So again grain size is decreasing, and is the in the distal part, in the distal part, as the slope is decreasing, so we can have the finer material. Suppose if I am taking or if I am considering this particular as a geographical location where in a particular time, suppose initially, so in this distal part, what will happen? We will be having the deposition of the fine sand or silty clay, which is mainly the stream flow, because of the stream flow that will be deposited. And with time, if this alluvial fan is progressing in nature, so within this particular zone or within this particular area, as these the sediments are progressing in nature, as the sediments are progressing from this side to this side, so what we can see just above this fine sandy silty or sandy material or the distal the product of the distal part will be in that particular geographical location, we will be getting the pebbles and sand mixed product of the, that is the mid fan material. And with further progressing, if the fan is progressing, then we will be getting the conglomerate, or that is the mainly the product of the debris flow. Okay, so in this way we can have a coarsening upward succession in a, so we will be having coarsening upward succession here in this if the fan is progressing in nature. On the other hand, suppose the fan is alluvial fan is integrating in nature, so initially in this particular geographical location, in this particular geographical location, we'll be having the deposition of the pebbles. So if that is retrograding, that means sediments are coming less. So this particular proximal zone will become, with time, will become mid fan zone, where that that pebble and sand mixture will be there. And with time, there in this same geographic, the distal part where we will be getting the finer material. Okay, so this alluvial fan, within this alluvial fan, we can define into different regions. One is this one, this proximal, this is mid fan zone, and this is distal part. Okay, so there are 3, 1, 2, and 3 major different physical processes are present within this. Okay, so that has been defined by different physical processes. But with time, what we are seeing, that the product of those particular physical set, we are getting one over another. Because of that, so if we are working on an alluvial fan, if we are getting this kind of progress, if we are getting this kind of coarsening upward sequence, if we are getting this kind of coarsening upward sequence, then we can say this fan was progressing in nature. And if we are seeing this kind of finding upward in nature, so that is that we can say that was a retrograding in nature. As with time, what we are seeing, the different product or the different sedimentary material, those are parallel, those are lying one above another, which was acting adjacent to each other. Okay, so that is the Walther's law. The depositional environment present adjacent to each other. So if we are seeing in a vertical profile, that defines that was that the cause of the product formation of those particular set of faces, that particular environment or the element was present adjacent to each other. That is why nowadays we are seeing one over another. Now Walther's law and rule of succession of faces. So again, we can say that a lateral faces relationship can be predicted by studying them in vertical succession. So if we could be able to define the how the depositional environment or the physical activity varied laterally adjacent to each other, then relationship tend to be gradual and stretched out over considerable distance. As so, if there is a gradational change from one faces to another faces, that defines that then laterally also we can have the this kind of faces variation. Now, few outcrops are long enough to reveal such features entirely. So this vertical as well as the lateral variation in few of the outcrops, that is, have to be tell regarding the depositional environment with time as well as with space also. Then paleogeographic reconstruction therefore relies heavily on the examination of vertical profile. Okay, so if we could do a vertical profile in a well manner, we could do the different identify the different faces succession or the different faces within that particular succession, that by that we can do a paleogeographic particular area or that particular sedimentary rocks. So here that gradational or the or vertical transition from one faces to another phase, original adjacency and genetic relationship during formation. Okay, so that means if we are getting some whatever changes in faces is there in a vertical succession, if those gradual in nature, so we can say with time gradually one environment shifts into another environment. Okay, and if there is a sharp or erosional contact, that does not tell any genetic relationship between the different faces. Okay, because they defines, if there is a sharp or erosional contact, they defines either there was a hiatus, there was a gap in between, or there were if or there was environment or the so things sharp or erosional contact, so does not tell any genetic relationship of the different so unit or the different faces. So in regression we will in under regressive condition we will be having a coarsening upward sequence, whereas in a transgression we will be having a fining upward sequence. Now faces emotional system and faces models. If we are working in an area where suppose we have prepared some vertical litholog like this, so you can see there are this the whole session is composed of, say this is 1 1 1 major sand body, another this is also a mainly calcareous sandstone, so this is also again, so this is one story, another story, another story, another story. Okay, and in between you have a muddy horizon which may be defined with the floodplain material. Here also muddy material, it may be defined as a floodplain material. Here also you can see muddy material, so that is again as a floodplain material. So by seeing this litholog, what we can infer that initially it was a product of fluvial deposit which has some intervening mudstone deposit of the floodplain of that particular fluvial environment or the system. Then that particular fluvial system, because here you can see this is as a whole, this is fining upward in nature, and at the upper part we are getting some limestone unit. So overall it is fining upward. So that particular fluvial environment has been gradually shifted to, say with the, here you can see these are the few of the fossils are present also, so gradually it shifts into marine or the shallow marine environment. So if we want to prepare some comprehensive model by studying or by preparing the different faces, so we can say initially it was some fluvial meandering fluvial deposit, then with transgression that fluvial deposit become braided river, then with transgression that become shallow marine environment. So in this way different faces or the faces associations, and we can prepare some depositional model for that particular set of faces. So in this way we can prepare or we can done our faces analysis, as well as we can prepare faces model of our own work. Then discussing all these things, now we need to know that how to perform faces analysis. So what is faces, what are the important thing that has been told, now how to perform faces analysis. So first of all, what are the procedure? So to perform faces analysis, what are those procedures? So first of all, that we need to measure the sections, or we need to measure the vertical by some borehole log. We have some borehole log, then we can these things from those core material. Then we need to develop a detailed graphic sedimentary log. After measuring, we need to prepare a graphic sedimentary log by using a different standard symbols. And after preparing those logs, maybe internet is it audible right now?
Is it audible? Yes, sir.
Okay. Maybe there is some. If all of you cannot hear me, then that is maybe the internet issue of this particular place, or some one or two. If you are unable to listen, then that means maybe internet issue is there. Okay. Okay. So we need to measure the section, then we need to develop detailed graphic sedimentary log, then we need to prepare a graphic sedimentary log, then evaluate associated section quantitatively or qualitatively. Okay, so whatever so if there are different sections just adjacent to that particular area, so quantitatively we need to prepare, as well as qualitatively very minutely we need to see those areas also, and then assess regional associations. What are the different regional associations are present within that area, then we need to compare those with the to the existing FACES model. Then after comparing all the suitable model, we need to prepare our FACES model. In this way we need to perform our sedimentary FACES analysis. Now how to make a stratigraphic column? So first of all, before measuring the section, we need to see the exposure or that particular section from a distance first, because when we will be seeing that particular section or the particular outcrops, when we will be seeing that particular section from a distance, so we will be having a comprehensive idea of that particular section or the outcrop as a whole. Okay, so after getting that comprehensive idea that these are the sand bodies, for example, these are the sand bodies associated with this, and we should club all these sand bodies with this one sand body. So that particular idea will be getting when we will be seeing that outcrop from a distance first. Then after getting that comprehensive idea, then we need to see what are the different changes taking place one over another. So we need to define the different litho unit on the basis of their characteristics, geometry of the litho unit, as well as the contact relationship of the litho unit. Suppose if we are getting some gradational contact within some different litho unit, so we can club them to with the one FACES, because these are genetically related. Suppose if we are getting one erosional contact within the different litho unit, so we need to consider them in a different litho unit, as a different litho unit. So after that idea, after seeing the different variation, then we need to measure the section. So that section measurement we can do, and whenever that we'll be measuring the sections, we need to see the different properties or the characteristics of the individual litho units. So that we need to describe in our field diary, or we need to note it down in our field diary. So in this way, we need to prepare a vertical column or a stratigraphic column. Now, how to draw a graphic sedimentary log? First of all, the vertical scale used to determine by the amount of detail required. So this one vertical scale, this is how much thickness you have measured, how much thicker section we have measured. So depending upon that, we need to take the scale for preparation of that particular lithology. Then in many schemes, the lithology is shown in a single column. So for example, we can take this column as a in a single column. So that will define the only the lithology and whatever structures we can put in this column. Then a horizontal scale used to use indicate the grain size or in clastic sediments. So in this horizontal scale, we can define the different grain size of the clastic material, depending upon which we can prepare the sedimentary log. So in this particular place, we can say this is up to a say medium sand range, ranges from medium sand. So this unit is starting from gravel and it is ending with the medium sand. So it is finding upward in nature. So in this way, we can prepare our graphic sedimentary log. By convention, the symbol used to whatever different sedimentary structures, the symbol of those structures wherever we are getting. So representative symbols we can put in this little log. And we can put the different bed boundaries, like whether it is sharp or erosional or gradational contact. So those bed boundaries we can put. And paleocurrent data, the paleocurrent data has been taken, we can prepare the rose diagram, and those things will also we can put just side of that particular lithologue. Now outcrop based vertical profiling. Suppose in this particular photograph, you can say that there are different litho unit. You can, by seeing these, anybody can say this is litho unit 1, this is litho unit 2, this is litho unit 3, and this is 4, and this is, by appearance, it is different. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 litho units are there, which are looking similar to each other. Okay, from distance we are getting there are 5 different litho units. But after suppose if you visit that particular, so there I can say that there are no 5 litho, not 5, there are only 3, 1 and then 2, then the whole unit is 3. So this is 1, this is 2, and this is 3. Why? Because when I go closer, then you can see that the internal things, the composition and all these things, those are similar with this and this. So these are similar litho units. So 1, 2 and 3. And this is nothing but the, because of the surface weathering, the color has been changed into a little bit brown in color. So this is one on all the same litho unit. So we can divide them into 3 litho units. If we want to prepare a vertical litho log here, so we can prepare our litho log like this, 1, 2 and 3 litho units. So in this way we can prepare our litho log, or you can measure the section. Now for facies analysis, we can also do some of the lateral sedimentary profiling also. So if we prepare some vertical litho log in a regular interval, then we can club them and we can prepare the lateral profiling also for that particular area. So we can have a lateral profiling also there. So in this way, if we are doing some lateral profiling, then we can extract the different elements of the depositional environment as a whole. We can extract all the things. Now coming to the paleocurrent analysis, this paleocurrent analysis is also very much important for facies analysis, and it is also we should do some paleocurrent analysis to know the provenance, to know the paleocurrent system of that particular area, as well as the to know the overall depositional environment under which that has been deposited. So paleocurrent indicators are oriented sedimentary structures interpreted to have been deposited by ancient flows. So what are those sedimentary structures? Those sedimentary structures are say cross beds, bevel imbrications, flute marks and ripple cross, if there are some asymmetric ripple also there, also from there also we can take the paleocurrent data. Now how to take the paleocurrent data from the outcrop? So if we are getting trough cross data, then say here that here in this particular figure you can see here some, you can see the, this is one trough cross data where different troughs are demarcated by white color chalk, and here you can see this is one trough cross data. So you can say this is the axis of that particular trough cross strata. Okay, so this is the trough axis. Here also you can see here some of the here also some of the trough cross strata are there. Here also you can see some of the trough cross strata are there. So this is the trough axis, and this will be our paleocurrent direction. So what we need to take, or what we need to do, so in this, towards this concave side of this trough cross strata, that will be our paleocurrent direction, not towards this convex side. Towards this concave side, that will be our paleocurrent direction. If that we are seeing on the plan or the on the plane, that at the surface of the earth or the surface of that particular rock. So what we need to do, we need to take our Brunton, aligning parallel with that trough axis, aligning parallel with the trough axis, and we need to put the north of this Brunton towards this concave side. So whatever data will be given in the northern by the northern needle, so that data will be our paleocurrent data. And you can say that that axis may be very much accurate. So these are all statistical data. So the more data we will be taking from the different trough cross data, when we will be doing the average, so our the error, there will be some error of making that trough axis. So that error we can negate if we have lot data with us. So the more data we will be towards the more towards the accuracy, and we can neglect those errors in this way. So the same things, to take the data of paleocurrent direction, we need to take the azimuthal reading from 0 to 360 degree. We need to keep the Brunton parallel to the trough axis. North of the Brunton should be projected towards the concave side of the trough. We need to note the data in our field diary, like in a 3-digit format, that is the azimuthal reading for graphic representation, that is rose diagram. We need to prepare some of the rose diagram. Now, how to prepare rose diagram, and what is rose diagram? Rose diagram is nothing but that. This is also a histogram diagram, as Shyam Sundar Singh Saab yesterday already told you regarding the histogram diagram. This is nothing but that. This is circular histogram diagram. We can divide them into different class interval. Say we can, depending upon the frequency or the of the data, we can make our class interval into either 20 degree class interval, or we can also make into 30 degree interval, like this also, depending upon the data frequency. Now, after that, if we define them into different class interval like this. So this is one class interval. So suppose we have three data, say 5 degree, 5 degree, 7 degree, and 8 degree. So we can prepare 1, 2, and 3. So up to there, you can prepare the rose diagram for this particular class interval. Okay. The same way, if suppose within this class interval 30 to 40 degree, suppose this is a 10 degree class interval. So if we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 data. So we can prepare we can prepare our this way. Okay. On the different readings, as well as we can also prepare frequency percentage, the whole data, how many data we have collected, and to prepare with respect to 100, how much percentage in within each class interval is there. So that also we can prepare, and in this way paleocurrent after preparing the rose diagram, we can have the different modes. Say for example, here you can see this is unimodal. This is particularly dominated by one mode towards the southwest, and it can have polymodal in nature. There are a lot of variation in the paleocurrent data, though there is a dominant mode, but this is mainly polymodal in nature. This is, you can say, this is bimodal in nature, and again this is also again a bimodal in nature, or rather polymodal in nature. So how the paleocurrent variation was there, that we can infer. Now this paleocurrent variation, after doing paleocurrent analysis, we can do the paleocurrent analysis with respect to time. So how the different paleocurrent or the paleo slope has been changed with time, as well as we can also interpret regarding the paleocurrent variation or the how the slope has been varies with respect to space. Okay, so both things we can do. So this is called the temporal paleographic sedimentary log, and if we are putting the different paleocurrent data just side of that particular log, and that will be defining the different paleocurrent with respect to the time. So with respect to time, how the paleocurrent has been changed or the varies, that is called the temporal paleocurrent variation. So we can say initially it was dominated, the current was dominated towards mainly towards south, then there was a bimodal in nature that has been shifted towards the southeast and southwest, and then you can have bimodal as well as bipolar current, then again bipolar current. So the paleocurrent has been changed, and it is also indicates that the paleocurrent has been changed because of the change in the depositional environment also. So in this way we can do the temporal paleocurrent variation. Now what is spatial paleocurrent variation? If we take the different paleocurrent data from the different places of a geological map or geological area of an area, so if we prepare that Rose diagram of that particular different places, and if we put those Rose diagram on that particular places, then we could be say regarding the spatial paleocurrent variation of that particular area. So in this way we can do the paleocurrent analysis. So in this way, this is very much important for facies analysis, this to infer the depositional environment. Analysis is very much important tool for doing facies analysis also. Now this is the we are almost end of this slide. So now this is the concluding thing. So after telling all these things regarding the facies and facies analysis, so what we can see in this particular slide, that see we are having the product, that is the rock, that is nothing but the facies and facies distribution. Okay, here within this basin we will be having this facies distribution. Now this facies distribution of or rock or that has been distributed, the arrangement of these facies will be dependent on the different parameters, like what is the different depositional environment present within that particular area, how much products are coming within the basin, then how the products are coming, that what was the how and what was the sediment pathway in which the sediments are coming, what was the tectonic subsidence rate. So depending upon that, the distribution of facies will depend. So here you can see there are mainly three things which are main contributing factor in distributing the facies or the arrangement of the different facies. So we can infer regarding the tectonic history of the basin by studying the facies analysis. We can infer regarding the climatic changes or climatic condition during the deposition by studying the facies, because all this climate or tectonic that will influence the distribution of the facies or the rock, and some of the signature will be trapped within the that particular set of facies or within the rock. If we could identify those things, we could be able to infer regarding that climate as well as tectonics. And another thing, that how that has been, that area or that locality has been connected to sea, whether transgression taking place, whether regression taking place, that also we could be able to infer. Okay, so by doing facies analysis, we could be able to infer regarding being the different element, like say what was the sediment pathway from which that sediments are coming, that was the what was the provenance of the area, what was the hinterland condition, and what was the erosion rate, what was the rainfall, what was the tectonic activity. So all the things will be the evidences of all the things will be entrapped within that particular set of faces. So if we study the faces in a particular manner, in a detailed way, so we could be able to say regarding the tectonics, regarding the climatic condition, regarding the sea level condition, as well as the overall what was the depositional environment or what was the changes in depositional environment, that also we could be able to infer. So that this faces distribution will be depending upon the sedimentary processes, what are the different depositional environment acting on different places. Depending upon that, the faces will be distributed or arranged, how the sediment supply, how and from where the sediments are supplying within that basin, then climate, then tectonic, and then sea level changes. So all the things we can infer by studying the distribution of the faces. So that's all for the concept of sedimentary faces analysis. Okay. Now the question is, after discussing all the things, is faces analysis is helpful in mapping or not? If yes, then how it is important? So that we need to find out, and that I will be telling after this lecture. So for this lecture, this is the end of this lecture. If you have any doubt or any query, you can ask, then we will move for the next lecture. If you have any query, any doubt, you can ask.